cross. And we want to be careful to not do that. Yeah, I thought that was a good introduction to what we're going to speak about this morning. So before we get started, I'd like to open with a word of prayer. And then we'll get into this and I'll have you out of here. Amen? Let's pray. Father, Lord, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, Lord. We thank you for the baby Jesus who became the 12-year-old boy who spoke in the temple, who became the man who ministered to the disciples and to those by the seaside, who became the man who went to the cross, who became the man, the Savior, who set the captives free, who became the man, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is now seated on the right hand of the Father. And we are awaiting his return. But Lord, this morning as we celebrate this Christmas time, this special day that has been set aside for the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ, Lord, I pray that our hearts and our minds would not just be focused on all that has come to this day, because there has been shopping and there has been dinners prepared and there has been so much that has led to this one day. Lord, let us take this time today and focus on the Lord. Now, Lord, open our minds, open our hearts. Help me to teach this so that you are glorified. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You know, it's funny because for this particular day, there are so many songs that have been written. And people are Christmas caroling, and we put lights up, and we go shopping, and we do so much. You know, it says that this is the most wonderful time of the year. Right? It's Christmas time. And, you know, a lot of people make a lot of money on Christmas songs during this year. I suggest that JR might consider writing one. But during this season, you know, it's amazing because I'm old enough to remember when Christmas actually didn't start until, you know, right before Christmas, people put up lights. And now, you know, it used to be a few years ago, I remember thinking, you know, when it was Thanksgiving, and then right after Thanksgiving, everything went up. But now it's like Halloween. You know, and retailers have really capitalized off of our sensitivity towards this time, and they use everything. And now that we have smartphones, if you're like me, I started getting these messages from retailers trying to sell me everything. And they kept reminding me. I think it was about 11 o'clock last night, I got my final little text from Dick's Sporting Goods. You know, and I think they were saying, you know, you still have time. You know? And Amazon said that if you ordered by 9:45 last night, that you could still get a gift in the mail. If you lived in a place where they had an Amazon place that could deliver, I thought, wow. But that's where we've come with Christmas. We've come to this season of Black Fridays and Cyber Mondays and, you know, everything that happens around it. And it's easy, though, in the hustle and bustle of Christmas to lose sight of the reason that we're here, the reason that Christmas exists. And, you know, if we study, Christ's birthday is not actually December 25th. But, however, you know, this is the season that we look at when we recognize the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's amazing that during this time of the year, because of Christmas, you and I, as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, more than anyone else should understand the reason for the season.
Amen.
And this should be an open door for us to minister to people who do not know. But the reality is that many of people who we interact with on a daily basis have absolutely no idea the true reason behind Christmas because of all of the commercialism that has taken over Christmas. And that somehow, some way, Jesus Christ has been lost in Christmas.
Amen.
He's been lost. The whole purpose for him being here. But today is a day that we set aside every year to recognize the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is what I thought is amazing, though. Even the lost world, people who don't know him, celebrate our Savior. You realize that? You know, jobs are closed today. Even on Sunday, if it were Monday, jobs would be closed. And the reality is that even atheists, people who say that he does not exist, have to stop and worship him today.
Amen.
And celebrate him
Amen.
Today. People who don't know him as Lord and Savior still have to stop and say, there is a day that has been set aside. And as much as people try to remove that, right? People say, let's have a holiday party. You know, let's have an Xmas party. They even want to X his name out, right? Let's have an Xmas party and let's do everything. But the reality is this. This is the day that we set aside to recognize the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. And no matter who you are, most people today are going to celebrate our Savior.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
They're going to celebrate our Savior. They're going to have a dinner around our Savior.
That's right.
Right? Songs have been written. Times have been made. This is a time that the whole world recognizes our Savior. And that's the God that we serve.
Amen.
That he would do that. And he would make even someone who does not know him as Lord and Savior still have to celebrate him. That's who we serve. When I know there's no day set aside for Muhammad. There's no day set aside for Muhammad. There are no songs even written about other religions. There are none. But we have songs that we sing every Sunday, and even more so during this Christmas time, about our Savior. Amen?
Amen.
Now, the true meaning of Christmas runs much deeper than the sales that we have set aside, than the dinners that we're going to have. And even the church service today, everything is runs deeper than that. Because here's the question that I want to challenge you today. Why did Christ come down? What is the true meaning of Christmas? Now, we understand that it's the celebration of God coming down from heaven, manifest and veiled in human flesh to be one of us. Paul wrote it this way in Romans chapter 8. He said, for what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God, sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh. That is what Christmas is all about. Is that God himself veiled his glory, his deity in human flesh, and came down as a person. That is what Christmas is about. So today I want to answer three questions. I want to look at three questions, and then we'll be done. These three questions are surrounded around who is he and why did he come down? There are three questions that beg to be answered concerning this man, Jesus Christ, the man who came down from heaven to be one among us. And the first one question is this. Who is he? The Hebrew writer put it this way. He says, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels. Why? He says, for the suffering of death. Then he was crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man, whether they accept him or reject him. That is who he was. Here, he is described as Jesus, the one who came down from heaven, the one born of the seed of Mary, born in a Bethlehem manger. And the Hebrew writer describes him this way. He who was made a little lower than the angel. Understand this principle. When God created Adam, he created Adam from the dust of the ground, the scripture says. Now, when you think of dust, dust is lower than dirt. Dust is just the particles that come from dirt.
Amen.
It is actually more than dirt itself, but Christ was made lower than the angels, while man was made lower than dirt. But God took that dust and formed that dust into the image and likeness of himself. But because of the fall of God's creation, you and I were made in the image of a fallen sinner. And we have to be lifted up in order to be made a little lower than the angels. We were exalted in being made a little lower than the angels, but the Lord Jesus Christ didn't go up to be a little lower than the angels. He came down.
Amen.
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 He wasn't created. He was made.
Uh-huh.
Our exaltation was at the expense of his humiliation. He came down to be one of us so that one day you might have the opportunity to go up.
Amen.
To be like him.
Amen. Amen.
What he did was, it says that he tasted death for every man, even those who reject him as Lord and Savior. The God of glory came to be just a little lower than the angels, to meet us where we are, to pay the penalty that Adam placed on every one of us in this room, to die in our place. But before the birth of Christ, God did something. He had to announce his coming. Understand something about Christmas Day. Christmas Day didn't happen upon people. It was fully prophesied for hundreds of years that he would come, that a star would be associated, that he would be born in the city of Bethlehem. People knew who he was, so that the wise men, when they saw this star, just didn't just look up and go, whoa. No, they had, that because of their wisdom and the wisdom of the Word of God, they understood the scriptures so that they knew the exact time that he was coming. But the angel of the Lord then, at the appointed time, announced the birth of the Savior. First, he announced it to Mary. It says this in Luke chapter 1. It says, and the angel said unto her, fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. It was told to Joseph in Matthew chapter 1. It says this. It says, then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. There was an announcement to the shepherds. It says this in Luke chapter 2. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And when you look at the name Jesus, the one that the angel of the Lord was announcing, it means Jehovah is salvation. Jesus is the Son of God. He is the Savior of mankind. He is God incarnated. He is Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us.
Amen.
Now the word Christ means the anointed as Christ. He was not just Jesus. He was also Christ, the anointed. He was the Jewish Messiah, the Son of God. But then he had three parts to his name, and he is the Lord, which means he is the person to whom a thing belongs, about which he has power to decide. He is master and he is Lord. And you need to know this, that not until his death, burial, and resurrection was he ever called all three names at once.
Amen.
It wasn't until his death, burial, and resurrection. Oh, they called him Jesus when he came. He was often called Christ Jesus. But he was often called Lord by itself. But not until his passion, his dissension, his ascension, was he then called Lord Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, the first time that it appears is in Acts chapter 2, in verse 36. And it said, therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God had made the same Jesus whom you crucified both Lord and Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ did this. He came to save us from sin. He came to seek, the scripture says, and save that which was lost. And it is him that we come together today to celebrate. He is worthy of our worship. And because of our individual worship, we should express that in our praise. Many do not believe in him. Many don't believe in his existence. But every Christmas, we celebrate with presents and gifts that we give to each other. Now I want you to think about it. What other man do we give each other gifts to celebrate his birthday? Unfortunately, we make the celebration all about us when the celebration should truly be about him.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Who is he? Who is this Jesus, the Christ, the anointed one, the Lord who was made a little lower than the angels, one that has been exalted to be called Lord? Here's my second point. Where did he come from? Says in Hebrews chapter 2, he says, for much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself, speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ, likewise took part of the same. I want you to think about that verse. Jesus, unlike me and you, was not just born. Often we think of this baby in a manger, right? And we see this baby in a manger. But according to Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14, he took part of flesh and blood. In other words, the birth of Christ is unlike any other birth that you've heard of. Jesus existed as God before time. He had no beginning. He shall have no end. He did not begin to exist at Bethlehem. He began to be human at Bethlehem.
Amen.
He had always existed. So at his birth, what he did was this. He added flesh and blood to an already existence. Deity became incarnated. Glory came down, veiled in flesh. Though he was the Son of God, he willingly became the Son of Man and the Son of Mary of the seed of David. Though he is part of the Godhead, along with the Father and the Holy Spirit, he chose to come down in human flesh, born alongside of animals in a lowly manger. He is the everlasting God. He had neither beginning nor ending. And yet, he grew within a virgin's womb and did this. He took part of flesh and blood. Just like you and I. Through the agency of the Holy Spirit, this is what happened. Emmanuel became a man. God became a man here on earth to be with us, to walk among us. God became a man. John put it this way in John chapter 1, verses 1, 2, and in verse 14. It says this, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." The same was in the beginning with God. But then verse 14 says, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." Think through that. Process that. He was in the beginning with God, but he was God. Then what he did was that he put on flesh, being God, and dwelt among us here on earth. It's the reason that most people can't comprehend it. Because they cannot process the fact that God, who is the Word, became a man and put on flesh. Here's the reality. He was in the Godhead. For 33 and a half years, he stepped out of the Godhead, leaving the Spirit and the Father. The Spirit could come and go, but then at the end of his earthly ministry, he tells the Spirit, "Unless I go, he cannot come." He then steps on, goes to, does his work. He does his priestly function here on earth. He then ascends back to the Father, rather than going back into the Godhead, where there would have now only been two. The Holy Spirit steps out of the Godhead, comes to earth. Christ sits on the right hand of God, where he is now seated.
Amen.
And the Holy Spirit is now here on earth, indwelling in you if
thank
you're saved.
Amen.
That's
amen.
How it works. That's exactly what took place. That's exactly what took place. Understand this. Mary, who knew no man, became pregnant, having never had sexual contact, never having the seed of man pass through her womb, and Christ the Savior was born of the Spirit. Where did Jesus come from? According to this verse, he was the incarnate Word at the beginning as God. But Jesus himself put it this way. In John 6, he says this. It says, "Then Jesus said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world." He didn't begin to exist at Bethlehem. He was God in the beginning, who then put on flesh, and the only thing he had to do then was come down from heaven. Unlike Adam, who was created from dust, he wasn't created that way. He always existed. He was always in the Godhead. All he did was put on flesh and came down from heaven. The picture is what happened in the wilderness with man. Says this in John 6:38. He says, "For I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me." Because he came down from heaven. Says this in verse 51 of John chapter 6. He says, "I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever, and the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world." Why? Because he was God already. All he did was put on human flesh to come down here to be like us.
Amen.
That's all he did. We look at Bethlehem as this phenomena. Let me tell you, they knew he was coming. The only thing, somebody told me this the other day, what the devil did not know was this. God had to save mankind. He desired to because of the sin that was passed on us from Adam. So what God did was he initially took Adam and said, I will then use you to procreate, to reproduce that which, or as the scripture says, to replenish that which was which I lost in the rebellion. The problem was that Satan, at that moment, figured out, okay, this is what God is going to do. He comes in, God puts Adam to sleep, he reaches into his womb and creates a womb man. He then takes the womb man and he causes her to do the thing that God told them would cause them to die. At that moment, he looks at God once they have eaten and says, now what, God? That which you have created to replace me, you can no longer use. Now, there's a whole lot more to the story.
Amen.
Because by Genesis chapter 6, he says, okay, if God's going to create man, he goes into the bodies of men, creates a race of giants in Genesis chapter 6, tries to get those people, God wipes them out in the flood. By the time you look at Moses, Pharaoh is wiping out every firstborn because he's firstborn male. Because he says, okay, if God is going to do this, then he's going to do it through a male. So he says, I'm going to wipe out every firstborn male. And it's this little chess match that goes on. Satan says, I'm going to do one thing. God says, no, I got checkmate. So then all of a sudden, it is a simple thing. The one thing that no one understood was that God was becoming man himself. God said, let me show you how I'll do this thing. I'll just put on flesh. Step out of the Godhead for a moment. And I will do what Adam failed to do.
Amen.
I will be able to bring salvation to mankind through my person. The problem is most men reject what God did for them by putting on human flesh. Unlike Adam, who's created in the image and likeness of God, Jesus was, he became our partaker of flesh and blood, and that separates his birth from any other birth ever taken place in the history of the universe. You know what the Bible calls what took place when Christ did that? It's called the mystery of godliness. Paul wrote it this way to Timothy. He says, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. Now, if you don't have a KJV 1611, this verse has been changed. Doesn't say this. And here it is. God was manifest in the flesh. Justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and then received up into glory. God was manifest in the flesh.
Amen.
That is Christmas Day.
Amen.
Prophetically, many knew that the Jewish Messiah was going to be born. They knew where he was to be born. They knew to look for a star to guide them. What no one knew was the mystery of godliness, because it was a mystery that had never been revealed to any Old Testament person ever on earth. The first person to reveal it was the Apostle Paul to the church when he wrote that. He wrote it in the book of Romans. What happened is this. God was manifest in the flesh, come down from heaven, veiled in human sinful flesh, to dwell among us, made a little lower than the angels, taking on the form of a servant, and Paul revealed the mystery to the church. Every religion in the world is centered in this. In man trying to reach up to God. Every religion of the world is centered in man trying to seek after God, to find God, but our faith, Christianity, is centered in God coming down from heaven to seek and save us.
Amen.
He became a ransom to many. He came to save us from the sin that was passed on to us from Adam. And because of us, he became one of us. He was fully man, yet he was fully God. Here's my third question. Why then did he come? He came to release us from the power of death. It says this in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. It says that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is, the devil. Jesus became a man, took on the form of a servant, took part of flesh and blood so that he could do what you and I could not do, and that through death he might destroy him that had power of death, that is, the devil. What separated him from any man was that while death destroyed most men, while death is the common denominator for all of mankind, with Christ, it was through death that he destroyed the devil, the one that has power over death. He confronted the devil. He destroyed him so that now, even though many of us don't realize this, he, the devil, is a defeated foe who was defeated at the cross of Calvary by the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ from the dead, so that you and I have obtained victory through Christ's suffering in our place on the cross. Amen. You know what that means?
Thank you, Lord.
While we are busy fighting, often we're fighting from a defeated position instead of fighting from a victorious position, because we have already obtained victory. Yet we don't operate in victory. We operate oftentimes in defeat, not realizing that we're fighting against a foe that was already defeated on the cross of Calvary. He lost already. Yet we give him power.
Yeah, we do.
We give him power, failing to realize that he has no power over us. He has no power because all of the power was given in the hand of the Lord Jesus Christ. So all we have to do is place our faith and our trust in one who defeated death over the one who had control over death, who is now defeated. And here's the problem. He knows that he's defeated. He knows that he lost. You know how at the end of the movie, the guy with the white hat and the horse always comes up riding? We know. Hey, you know what? If you've got this book, you know the end of the movie.
Amen.
You know what happens in the end. Our problem is that we end up living in defeat because our focus is not on him. It's on what goes on this earth. It's in the battle that we're waging against flesh and blood, against each other, instead of realizing that we have won. The war is over. The battle is not yours, it's the Lord's. It's not our war. We don't have to fight in this war. We won already. You know what we're waiting now? We're waiting for the victor to come and take us home. That's the only thing we're waiting for. So that we can then receive all that he has for us, so that when we come back at the Battle of Armageddon and fight, you know what? Then we're fighting, we get our weapons. If you've been in the military, and I have, there comes a time in basic training where they issue you your weapon. And what they do is they tell you to learn your weapon. You take it apart, you tear it down, you put it back together. You sleep with it. You learn it. You do everything with it. You know what? We're getting ready to get our marching orders. We're getting ready to be taken out of here so that we can receive the spiritual weapons that he has for us. But what he wants us to do is not be defeated in the process, so that we walk around earth always defeated. We're defeated financially. We're defeated in our marriages. We're defeated in our workplace. We're defeated in our home. We've got all these areas, but here's the reality. If you place your faith and your trust in Him, if you give all that you have to Him, and faith is what you don't see. Our problem is that we want to see it. Well, hold on there. I want to see what God has for me. No. Faith is the substance of things not seen, right? So what happens is this. We have to just blindly, because you don't see the Lord physically, place your faith in the fact that He came one day, veiled in flesh. He put on human flesh. That's what He did. He came down from heaven. God manifest in the flesh. He lived a sinful, a sinless life on this earth for 33 and a half years. And then He defeated the one thing that no man ever cheated death. No man cheats death. I can tell you this. If you live long enough and He doesn't come back, you're going to die.
Amen.
There was no way to cheat this. But you know what? He didn't cheat it either. Because He died at the hands of mortal men. The difference was this. Up from the grave He rose. Because really, Christmas is about Easter. You know that?
Amen.
Christmas is just the start of the story. Easter is what we celebrate. So we need to, we're not going to bring out a bunny. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We're not going to dress Penny up. But the reality is that Christmas is really about the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You know what? Because He came really to die. But He came not to die, He came to defeat that. That's what Christmas is really all about. And I'm telling you, every retailer tries to take advantage of our Savior.
Amen.
That's what they do. They take advantage of our Savior.
That's right.
They take advantage of it. And they know that we end up, some of us will not finish playing for today, this time, by this time, next year.
My Lord.
And He knows it. And He gets you so in debt for this day. Some of us still are paying for last Christmas.
Hmm.
We paid that card off. That we didn't do anything. We know we did. Okay? This is what Christ did. He confronted the devil. He destroyed him. So that now, even though many of us don't realize that He's defeated, He defeated Him on the cross of Calvary by resurrecting from the dead so that you and I can now obtain victory through Christ's suffering in our place on the cross. 1 John 3:8 says this. He that committeth sin is of the devil. For the devil sinneth from the beginning. But understand this sin. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested. That He might destroy the works of the devil. The very things that are destroying us. So at the cross of Calvary, Satan, sin, and death were brought up before God in judgment. And if you're saved, the only thing that you are waiting for now, since those things have been judged, you know, and you guys have heard me say, do you realize that God, when you stand before God, He can't judge you for sin? Realize it? Oh, I know you're committing sin. All of us do. I'm not saying you. Right? We all commit sin. But do you realize that God cannot judge you for sin? He cannot. Now, that doesn't mean you get a pass from sin.
Amen.
It's just that God, when you stand before Him, if you're saved, cannot judge you for all the sin that you commit. Because if He did, Christ's death would be in vain. Because Christ has already paid the penalty for your sins.
Thank you,
Lord. You better be glad.
Thank you, Lord.
You better be glad that God can't judge you for what you're doing.
Hmm.
Come on now.
Go ahead.
So what He does is this. If you're saved, and you guys have been around, you know this. If you are living a life of sin and you're not being chastised, you're not being whooped, if you think you're getting away with sin, if you're living a life of sin and there is no consequences to what you're doing, you probably may not be saved, according to the scripture. Because every good father, you know what he does? He whoops your butt when you mess up.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
See, but if you're doing your due and then you go wake up the next morning and say, that was easy. I didn't even get in trouble for it. And then you do it the next day. And then you do it the next day. And before you know it, you're living a life of sin. But you're never getting whooped for it. Mm. It is probably because Jesus said this in John 8:44. Ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and it bowed down the truth, because there is no truth in it. When he speaketh the lie, he speaketh of his own. Then you probably need to get saved. But if you're getting whooped, hallelujah.
Amen.
If you like getting whooped, keep doing it. If you don't like getting whooped, then you know what? Give that thing over to God.
Amen. Amen.
Just give it over to God and say, God, left to my own devices, I'm going to keep doing it. All of us. The scripture talks about the sin that does so easily beset. I love that verse. Because all of us have some struggle. Here's the difference. And understand this. If you're saved, sin should be very acute to you. The minute you do it, the Holy Spirit of God in you ought to say, that ain't right. The minute you do it again, the Holy Spirit of God said, you're getting close. Keep doing it.
Amen.
There ought to be a conviction in you that says, I cannot continue to do this.
Amen.
I know I can do it.
Amen.
I'm as capable of doing it as the next man. But the Holy Spirit of God ought to be kicking you. MMA. You know how you go MMA on somebody? Right? Isn't that how you go? Right? That's the way the Holy Spirit of God will be doing that. You know, he'll be saying, this ain't right. Don't take me to that club. Don't lie me in that bed. Don't put that in me. I don't want that in me. But if you're not saved, you can do it and you think nothing of it. You don't think anything of it. Because you're not saved, because there is no person living in you convicting you. Do you realize that that is why Christmas exists? Because left to our own devices, we couldn't save ourselves.
Amen.
We couldn't save ourselves. We had no hope. We couldn't save ourselves. Our conscience was never good enough to let us know. And that was the only thing controlling us. It was controlling us and saying, that ain't right, but you keep doing it. Now that Christ has died, come down in flesh, resurrected, defeated death, which was the one hold that Satan had on us, or he had it, you now are victorious. You have victory. You no longer have to live a life of sin. You have been set free from the shackles of sin, from the slavery of sin. You were bought with a price. Christ paid the penalty for your sin. Now you were his. He owns you, and he wants to control you and tell you what to do. But you know what? We keep running back to the plantation. We keep running back to that sin. We keep running back to it because we're used to it. The sin of Adam left us in a very bad place. You realize that? Sin always leaves a man worse than when it found him. Christ came down to earth and died in our place so that now if you're in Christ, you have no more reason to fear death because through Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, he has become the first fruits of them that sin. It says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. It says, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are all, of all men, most miserable. It says, but now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. Hallelujah.
Amen.
There are people that are so afraid of death, they spend their entire life in fear of dying. They do everything possible to prolong their expectancy on this earth. I saw where Zsa Zsa Gabor died. 99. She prolonged her death for so long. Unfortunately, I think she had her legs amputated by then. You know, she was a gorgeous woman. There's no telling how much she spent to remain gorgeous. But let me tell you something. You don't remain gorgeous forever.
Amen.
At some point, it catches up to you. Even Maybelline can't say it. Christ took the sting out of death so that you and I do not have the fear of death, to be afraid of death because of Christ's resurrection. We can now have confidence in death. Let me explain to you. You may think this strange. You know, because people come to me and they may say this to you. You'll say, how are you doing? They'll say, good thing, boy. It could be worse. I could not be here. I could be dead this morning. And I think, if I'm not here and I'm dead this morning, I got promoted. It could never be worse for me to die. Now, I'm not looking forward to dying because I believe, you know, to just die, you know, because of my wife, you know, because of my children, because of different things. But you know, let me explain something to you. You may miss me, but I doubt it that I'll miss you. In death. Hear me. That's just the way death is for a believer. We have hope in death.
Amen.
We have all of the hope in the world in not being here anymore. Hallelujah, when I'm not here, believe me, that's when life starts. Mm-hmm. At death.
Yeah.
You realize that?
Amen.
Life actually doesn't really begin until you die. Yeah. If you don't get that, you will hopefully, because I'm almost done. Says this. What he did was that he came down finally to identify with us. Says this in Hebrews 2:16. For verily he took not on him the nature of angels. And he couldn't. You realize, God, he could have been created as an angel. But that's not the nature that he took on. But he took on him the seed of Abraham. He became a man. Our salvation for it. Christ could have come in the form of angels. He could have taken on the nature of angels. But for us, so that he could identify with us, he took on the form of sinful flesh. Says this in Romans 8. We just looked at this in the beginning. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, but he condemned him in the flesh. And here's what we didn't look at. Why? That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. But finally, he did this. He came down to make reconciliation for our sin. Something had to atone for your sin. Hebrews 2 says this, wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren. Why? That it might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, for this reason, to make reconciliation of the sins of the people. Do you realize that without Christ's death, without Christmas, there was no way to reconcile you back to God? You couldn't do it just being a good person. You can join the Boy Scouts, the Girl Scouts, the Brownie, the Campfire Girl. You can help old ladies across the street. You can become Mother Teresa. And let me explain something to you about Mother Teresa. Her good works could never earn her entrance into heaven.
Amen. That's
right. She was a good one. She did more than most of us will ever do for mankind. But if she's depending upon that to get her into heaven, right now, she woke her eyes up and said, my. I never placed my faith in the trust in the one I depended upon me. If a person thinks that they can fly a plane into buildings, blow up people, or drive a truck into a bunch of people and commit suicide in doing so, if they think that they can strap bombs on themselves, blow themselves up, that will get them entrance into heaven and some virgins for doing it, they are in trouble.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Somebody duped them. They got hoodwinked and bamboozled. And that is what man thinks. Man thinks that he can earn his way into heaven. Let me let you in on a secret. You could not. And if you could, it would nullify the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross so that your good works would get you in. Let me explain something to you. Keep working. Let you think that your works do anything for you. If you've not placed your faith truly, and I'm not talking about confess with your mouth, if you've never really believed it in your heart, let me explain something to you. And somebody told me this the other day, reminded me, I say this all the time. You're rolling the dice. You know what you'd be safer doing? Grabbing a 357 and playing Russian roulette. And placing your faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ. It's Christmas. We go beyond the birth of a baby.
Amen.
This is about the death, burial, and resurrection of a Savior. Who died and rose from the dead to give you eternal life. With it, without it, you have no hope.
Amen.
All he was, though, was this. He was God, manifest in the flesh, come down from heaven, veiled in flesh, tempted like as we are, yet without sin, hung on a tree at the hands of mortal men, died, was buried, set the captives free. Hallelujah. Come, walked the earth for 40 days, ascended to the Father. Holy Spirit descended, now can live in you. Otherwise, the only thing you have is your conscience, and you're in trouble. That's the way I see it. I've never understood it in that way. Now here's my question to you. Who have you placed your faith in your trust in? Who are you trusting to? Who would you place your faith and trust in? Some of us spent a lot of money. Some of us really dumped some money in today. Our kids are so happy. Some of us really spent a lot of money today. Some of us are probably sitting here, can't even get through the sermon, thinking about, oh, money. Okay, you spent it. Your kids gonna grow out of them, see?
See. Put that game down.
Where's my man TJ? He's been a great. I love him. One day he won't even care about that basketball.
See.
Thank you for giving it. Did you give it for? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord for the basketball. I may even go play a little one-on-one with it. But this time next year, where's the basketball?
See.
You better invest in eternity. Right? You better place your faith and hope in something that never goes away.
Amen.
And that is what Christmas is all about. Amen? Let's pray. Father, Lord, we thank you. I love you, Lord, for taking my sin, the sin that I deserve, the sin that was placed onto me from Adam, the sin that had a penalty attached to it, and that penalty being death. I thank you for dying in my place.